How do preferences work when voting in Australian federal elections? Voting with preferences holds a lot of mystery and confusion for many first-time voters, as well as Australians who've been voting for a long time. However, it's extremely important to understand how our democracy works and how to vote, so you can make it work for you without being led astray by self-serving politicians or mainstream media agendas. Here's a quick explanation of how preferences work, so you can think for yourself and increase the quality of representation in our government. Write any questions you have, which I may not answer, in the comments below, and share this video with your friends. The federal parliament is made up of two chambers, also called houses or assemblies. The House of Representatives is also called the lower house. The Senate is called the upper house. Legislation is only passed and becomes law when a majority of the politicians in both houses vote in favour of it. There are 150 members of parliament elected to the House of Representatives, each representing a voting district called an electorate. Every 3 years we have a federal election when all seats are declared vacant and must be voted for again. The government is generally formed by the party or team of parties, which gains a clear majority of the 150 seats. The opposition is formed by the party with the next greatest number of seats. Only the government MPs get to vote on who their leader in parliament is, and that person becomes the Prime Minister. We don't get to vote for the Prime Minister. We only get to vote for the Member of Parliament to represent our electorate. To do that, we have to complete an official piece of paper called a ballot and vote either via post or at an official voting location called a polling place on election day or in a limited time before election day. Every approved candidate for your electorate will be listed on your ballot paper with an empty box beside their name. It is compulsory to number every box with a 1 for your favourite candidate, a 2 for your second favourite candidate, a 3 for your third favourite candidate, and so on down your list until you put the highest number for your least preferred candidate last. You may not put any other marks on your ballot. You may not leave any boxes empty. You may not skip any numbers. If you make a mistake, you should ask the polling official for a new ballot. It's very important to get it right. This system is called compulsory preferential voting. When the votes are counted after the polls have closed, the person with the lowest number of votes is excluded, and all of the ballots in his or her pile are examined to see who got the second preference vote on each ballot. Those votes then go to the respective candidates, and their total number of votes is increased accordingly. Then the candidate with the lowest number of votes will again be knocked out of the running, and the ballots in their pile will be distributed to the remaining candidates with the highest preference on each ballot being redistributed. This process happens over and over again until all but two candidates remain in the contest and the person with the most votes is declared the winner. If you sequentially numbered every box on your ballot and your primary preference, your favourite candidate, was knocked out early on, your vote can't be wasted because it will keep moving to support your next favourite candidate. The person you voted was the best amongst the candidates remaining. You don't get extra votes. The full value of your one vote simply moves from one candidate to another until you finally get a say between the two most popularly preferred candidates. One of the myths thrown around carelessly, especially by major political parties, is the danger of splitting the vote if too many similar candidates run for election. The opposite is in fact true. Because of preferential voting, your vote is never, ever wasted if you number every box and everyone's voice is heard when it finally comes down to the two most popular candidates. This means you can safely vote for a minor party candidate, confident that if they're excluded before the final two, your vote will still have full value in helping decide between the final two. Another myth is that political parties control voter preferences. That simply isn't true. The only person controlling the distribution of preferences is the person marking the secret ballot in the privacy of their voting booth, you. The only choices parties and politicians have is what preference recommendations they will make on their how to vote flyers, which are offered by their volunteers on election day. You don't even have to take these. If you want to be a responsible, patriotic voter who doesn't waste their vote for our future, care enough about your neighbours and nation to decide before election day which candidate represents your values best and in what order you prefer the other candidates to represent your values when important issues come before Parliament. If you don't know how the other candidates represent you, Google them and ask. No one controls your preferences except you. Is this video helping you? If so, please share it. Please remember, this explanation only applies to federal elections. The rules for state elections are a little different and vary from state to state. Now, while you vote for a single local representative for your electorate in the lower house, you also get to vote for the representatives of your whole state in the upper house, also called the Senate. That's the huge white ballot with dozens and dozens of candidates' names on it. Each state has 12 senators and each territory has just two, and half of the state senators must alternately recontest their position at each election to be elected for a six-year term starting July 1st. They don't represent a local electorate or even a region. Your whole state or territory is their electorate. To make your Senate ballot a valid vote, you must number at least six groups of candidates above the line, or at least 12 individual candidates below the thick black line. If you vote above the line, the candidates in the groups you vote for will get your vote in the order they're already printed on the ballot. If you want to vote for them in a different order of preferences, you'll need to vote for them below the line, in the order you prefer, and completely ignore all boxes above the line. When voting below the line, you have maximum control over your preferences and can vote for anyone in any group in any order, as long as you number at least 12 boxes and don't repeat or skip any numbers. In my opinion, the upper house is where minor parties and independents can be most useful to prevent a bad government from doing too much damage by blocking bad legislation. That's what the Senate is for. While it can be daunting to number every single box below the line, doing so will give you the most control over your vote and the best government possible. If you don't number every box, there's a chance your vote could be exhausted and wasted if all the people you did vote for got excluded before the final round. One way to reduce the risk of not numbering every box is to make sure you vote for at least one major party candidate, as they are the most likely to be in the final round anyway. That way, even if you do give your higher vote preferences in the Senate to minor party candidates, your vote has very little chance of being exhausted, which means running out of candidates you voted for, as long as you eventually voted for one or more major party candidates. Of course, if you number every box below the line and carefully double check to make sure you haven't skipped or repeated any numbers, you can be guaranteed your vote cannot be wasted and that you're not splitting the vote. Remember, if you do make a mistake, you can always get a fresh one from a polling official. The current Senate voting rules have removed any advantage minor parties previously had and now tend to favour medium-sized parties when people simply vote above the line. The most control and best result for your vote will be if you number as many boxes as possible below the line. You may not usually be interested in politics, and it might be more complicated than you like, but it is less effort than some important purchases, and getting it wrong can severely affect or tremendously help a lot more people. Let's care about other people enough to put the modest effort required into understanding our democracy and how voting works, and get the best government possible. If you have any questions or would like me to make a video explaining anything else, please leave a comment below. If you like someone else's question or suggestion, give it a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and click the bell to see new videos first. If you think this video could help people you know, please share it on your favorite social media channels and head over to davepellowe.com to subscribe to my newsletter and see recent videos and articles. This video was brought to you by the Pellowe Talk Partners, individuals helping educate and empower people to promote just and wise government.